Hi everyone, this is Dr. J, and in this video I'm going to give you a brief overview of the first section of the chapter 13 in the textbook. This module we're talking about GPR, ground penetrating radar, and I want to give you, well, the way the module is broken up, we kind of have three different sections, two on the theory behind GPR, and that'll be two parts of chapter 13 in the textbook. And then chapter 14 in the textbook will be the third part, which is applications of GPR. So this chapter, just to say something at the beginning, is a little bit more heavy on the theory side than some of the other work that we've done so far in the class. But that's important for this chapter because GPR, it's really important to have a good understanding of what the instrument can and can't do. And in order to decide that or determine that, you need to know the theory behind how it works. I'm going to start us out by just talking kind of at a high level about the theoretical parts of the first section in the chapter. This is mostly actually in section 13.3, as well as a little bit in 13.1 and 0.2 and 13.4. So fundamentally, GPR is measuring, it's giving us two parameters. And the two different things that it's giving us are fundamentally two-way travel time and amplitude. So we have a system where we have our GPR at the surface. Maybe we're pushing it along. And we're sending out a signal, and that signal is encountering reflectors. Now, the signal that we're sending out is not seismic, in this case, but electromagnetic radiation. It's radio waves, essentially, that are penetrating down to the ground. Radio waves are a type of light, or a type of electromagnetic radiation. So we're sending out these waves into the ground, they encounter a reflector, and we get a return signal. Unlike some of the seismic methods that we've used, radar, or GPR, I should say, is more or less sending the signal straight down into the subsurface and receiving a signal straight back up. So mostly straight up and down motion, although not necessarily entirely. And so you can see we're sending our signal straight down and we're getting a reflected signal traveling straight back up. And this is the assumption that the book will make in a number of the equations, that the signal is essentially going straight down, coming straight up, and interacting kind of straight on to the reflectors. So the two-way travel time, obviously we send out a pulse, so maybe we send down a signal with a particular frequency and phase and length characteristics, and then we receive that pulse back. And by differencing the time between the sent out pulse and the received pulse, you can compute the two-way travel time. So that's the first fundamental measurement. How strong of a reflector this reflective surface is, or maybe it's a pipe or whatever it is, how strong of a reflector that is going to dictate the amplitude of the signal that we get back. So amplitude and two-way travel time are the two fundamental things that the GPR is measuring. And so in this case, if we plotted this up as a section, this section over here is our data section, then we would see at some particular time, which is related to the depth here, and in this case, we'd see essentially, because there's no other reflectors in this very simple diagram, we would just see this one reflector. The distance between the start of the section, the beginning of the transmission time, and where we see the reflector, this is related to the two-way travel time. It's not the actual distance, right? So in order to get the distance, we have to first measure the time, and then we have to know about the velocity. So if we want to get the distance over here, this is distance d, and keep in mind these two drawings I'm drawing them on kind of the same scale, but they're two different things. This here is the actual data in the real Earth, and this here is what we're measuring, what we would see on a GPR, like the screen that we're looking at. This is what the data section would look like. So there's some travel time distance, and that's related to, and this is actually the two-way travel time, right? So the distance is going to be equal to the two-way travel time divided by 2. So we have our time for one direction, and then we need the velocity. And in this case, we'll need the velocity in this first layer. Now going back to our two fundamental measurements, we have our two-way travel time and our amplitude. Those are both related to the velocity in the subsurface, obviously, as I've already mentioned. The amplitude is related to the amount of energy that's reflected back from a particular reflective surface. And that's related to the velocity contrast at that surface. So the book gives you this reflection coefficient. The value r is just a reflection coefficient. It's the amount of energy that gets reflected back. And that's related to the difference in velocities across that medium. This is under a particular set of assumptions, so it's not necessarily something that we're going to use a lot in the class. But the point is that the difference in velocity between two mediums is going to affect how much you get reflected back. If there's a large difference, if V1 is very different from V2, you might get a large reflector. If V1 and V2 are almost the same, then you'll essentially get no reflectance, right? So if V1 equals V2, this becomes zero and there's no reflected wave. So the velocity contrast is what's important for being able to see the boundary or the pipe or whatever in the subsurface. And then the velocity itself, which is related to the two-way travel time. So two-way travel time over 2 times the velocity in the meat of the wave as it's traveling through, that might vary with depth. So velocity z. And then we probably need to integrate that over z. That's going to equal to the distance. And the distance traveled is the depth of that pipe or layer or whatever. So d and v, velocity and distance, or depth in most cases, is really what we're interested in. And we need to understand what affects the velocity. Okay, so in the book gives you in box 13.1, I think, it gives an expression for the velocity of a electromagnetic wave in a medium. And I'm not going to write down the whole equation, you can see it in the book. I'll just write down the proportionality. So it's going to be related to the speed of light in a vacuum, times some scaling factor, which is 1 over epsilon sub r, which is the dielectric constant, the relative dielectric constant, the magnetic permeability, mu sub r, which is going to be a 1 for most non-magnetic materials, the dielectric constant, relative dielectric constant, and the magnetic permeability, those are to a power 1/2, or minus 1/2, since they're in the denominator, and then p. Okay, so this is the proportionality. Velocity of an electromagnetic wave in some medium is equal to the speed of light normalized by the dielectric, relative dielectric constant, the magnetic permeability, both of those to the 1/2 power, and then this p factor. And we'll talk about p in just a second. So what you can see here is that for values that have higher dielectric constants, the velocity is going to be slower, right? So you divide by a larger value and your velocity goes down. And then for values where p is high, and p is called a loss factor, the loss factor is higher, that also results in a lower velocity. P is proportional to sigma. We got lots of letters today. Sigma is the bulk conductivity. So again, we see our bulk conductivity, frequency is f, and dielectric, relative dielectric constant is e epsilon sub r. So this is what we get from this loss factor. Another term that the book uses for p is tan d. This is just a definition. So tangent d is equal to p. So don't worry too much about that. It's a little bit confusing in the book because they use both of these in different places. But tan d is just equal to p. So bulk conductivity is the the electrical conductivity of the medium, dielectric, relative dielectric constant, and then frequency is the frequency of the electromagnetic wave that you're sending down at the subsurface. Okay. So the point here is that depending on what these constants are, that determines the velocity. And then the velocity determines the two-way travel time, and the velocity contrast between boundaries determine the amplitude of the reflection. So essentially what we have here is, in order to use GPR, in order for GPR to work, to be useful, what we need to have is velocity contrasts, so contrasts in the dielectric, relative dielectric constant, conductivity, p, the overall loss, which is dependent on frequency, and the magnetic permeability, although that's not necessarily going to be so important unless we're encountering metal pipes. What we need to have are values of those parameters that are different between two layers, or between the bulk geologic medium and the pipe, whatever it is you're trying to detect. The contrast in these parameters needs to be such that we actually get a velocity contrast, which will allow us to see our reflective boundary. And we need those boundaries to be far enough away from each other that the two-way travel time is different enough so that when we plot that section, that data section, where we're plotting two-way travel time and then amplitude, and there's some examples in the book. For example, 13.1 shows a radar gram, and you can see as you kind of go down in depth, the two-way travel time goes up, and then there's various reflectors at different amplitudes, and you're seeing all of those things. If you have two reflectors which are so close to each other that the two-way travel times are essentially indistinguishable at the precision of your radar, and that depends on frequency, then you're not going to be able to tell the difference between those two objects. If your velocity contrast, because your dielectric property, your magnetic properties, or your loss, including the bulk conductivity, if those properties are too similar between two different mediums, you're not going to be able to see a strong amplitude reflector, and that means you're not going to be able to tell whether or not there's actually a boundary there. But these are very important for understanding how the GPR works. If we don't have strong contrast in dielectric, the relative dielectric constant, the bulk conductivity, and the magnetic permeability, excuse me, if our frequency is such, if our frequency is such with these other parameters that we're not able to get strong reflective coefficients or differences in the two-way travel time, we're not going to be able to do what we are wanting to do with the GPR. This is why frequency is so important for GPR, and the instruments that you'll get will be designated by a particular frequency. And that frequency is usually at the center frequency. There's usually some range around that frequency that it works. Okay, but that frequency is very important because of these issues. One final thing that is important. Well, so what I'm talking about essentially is resolution. So whether or not you can resolve two pipes that are close together, whether or not you can resolve spatial variations where the pipe begins and ends, those are all issues of resolution. Okay, so when we talk about resolution with GPR, there's two kinds. One is horizontal and one is vertical. So resolution of a GPR, you have both vertical and horizontal resolution. So your vertical resolution is related to your two-way travel time and your amplitude. That's what we talked about earlier. And the loss factor. And the loss factor is related to 1 over frequency. Now, there's also this issue of skin depth the book talks about. The skin depth is the depth at which you have 1 over E or 37% of your original signal amplitude left, something like that. And the skin depth is essentially related to the vertical resolution. And that skin depth is proportional to 1 over alpha. Another letter, yes, I know. Another Greek letter, yes, I know. But 1 over alpha, or alpha, I should say, alpha is the attenuation constant. Let's see, alpha is some complicated expression, but it's dependent on frequency, omega. Okay, and there's some other, there's some other numbers. This is just proportionality. There's some other numbers in there that you can see in the book. But basically, you see the same thing. So attenuation is proportional to frequency, so higher frequencies are attenuated more. It's proportional to the dielectric, relative dielectric constant. So higher dielectric constants tend to attenuate more. And then it's proportional to the loss factor. So the loss factor is, which also has the dielectric constant in it, higher loss factor means higher attenuation. So attenuation is related to all of these things, and so we can begin to build up kind of a conceptual picture of what's happening here. Higher frequencies means more attenuation, means a lower or a shallower skin depth. So higher frequencies don't penetrate as deep. Higher relative dielectric constant means you don't penetrate as deep. You have higher attenuation, you don't penetrate as deep. Higher loss factor tends to mean higher attenuation, which means you don't penetrate as deep. So higher loss means you don't have as much depth penetration, but you have more resolution. So higher frequency also means higher resolution. If loss is 1 over frequency, resolution is proportional to frequency. Okay, and then conversely, if we have lower frequencies, lower dielectric constants, lower loss, we're going to have greater depth penetration, we'll have a larger skin depth, but our resolution, lower frequency means lower resolution, our resolution will be lower. For high vertical resolution, we want high F, high P, high alpha. So high attenuation, high loss, high frequencies all translate to high vertical resolution, but also want to say high vertical resolution equals a shallow depth of penetration. So you're not penetrating as deep. Shallow depths equals higher resolution. So equals small skin depth. Okay, so higher resolution, higher vertical resolution equals a smaller skin depth. On the other hand, if we have low resolution, we have low F, low P, low alpha, those are all related to low resolution, but higher skin depth. That's supposed to say SD, SD for skin depth. So low resolution equals higher skin depth, high resolution equals a smaller skin depth. So this makes sense, right? So as you penetrate down further, you lose resolution. If you're only looking at very shallow subsurface, you're getting higher resolution. All right? So that's one of the main things I wanted to bring out. For horizontal resolution. Okay, so that's all vertical resolution. What about horizontal resolution? Horizontal resolution is really related to the... So here's our problem again. Here's our GPR. The actual signal that gets sent out by a GPR, it's not just a single ray, it's a kind of a cone-shaped thing. And the Fresnel zone is related to the width of that, called FZ for Fresnel zone. The book talks a lot about that. The width of that cone, essentially, when it intersects the reflector, has to do with the horizontal resolution. And so you can imagine if you have pipes that you're trying to see, let's say you're going across those pipes and they're like this. I don't know if you can see that. Let me draw this a little bigger. Okay, so here's your thing coming down and then you're intersecting a bunch of pipes, right? Okay, so here's your Fresnel zone. Right, so there's your Fresnel zone, there's your width, here's your signal coming down, and you have all these pipes down here. You're not going to be able to distinguish, right? You're just going to get a single reflector back from this whole group. You're not going to be able to tell if there's one pipe there or one, two, three, four pipes there in this particular example. So this is kind of the key behind horizontal resolution, has to do with this Fresnel zone, which has to do with just the width of that downgoing cone. All right, so you'll see more details about all of this in the book. Please do read the book. And as I said, this is a little bit more theoretical of a chapter, a little bit more theoretical of a module. If you have questions, post them on Piazza, come to office hours, and hopefully we'll get those straightened out for you. All right, so with that, I will say hopefully that helps a bit, and I will see you in the next video.